read the scripture for March 13th to you today. Matthew chapter 8, verses 5 through 13 from the Common English Bible. When Jesus went to Capernaum, a centurion approached, pleading with him, "Lord, my servant is flat on his back at home, paralyzed, and his suffering is awful." Jesus responded, "I'll come and heal him." But the centurion replied, "Lord, I don't deserve to have you come under my roof. Just say the word and my servant will be healed. I'm a man under authority with soldiers under me. I say to one, go and he goes, and to another, come and he comes. I say to my servant, do this and the servant does it." When Jesus heard this, he was impressed and said to the people following him, "I say to you with all seriousness that even in Israel, I haven't found faith like this. I say to you that there are many who will come from east and west and sit down to eat with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, but the children of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness. People, there will be weeping and grinding their teeth." Jesus said to the centurion, "Go, it will be done for you just as you have believed." And his servant was healed that very moment. And our last scripture for today comes from Luke chapter 23, verses 32 to 34. Verses 36 to 38 and 44 to 47 from the Common English Bible. They also led two other criminals to be executed with Jesus. When they arrived at the place called the Skull, they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." They drew lots as a way of dividing up his clothing. The soldiers mocked him. They came up to him, offering him sour wine and saying, "If you're really the king of the Jews, save yourself." Above his head was a notice of the formal charge against him. It read, "This is the king of the Jews." It was now about noon, and darkness covered the whole earth until about 3 o'clock, while the sun stopped shining. Then the curtain in the sanctuary tore down the middle. Crying out in a loud voice, Jesus said, "Father, into your hands I entrust my life." After he said this, he breathed for the last time. When the centurion saw what happened, he praised God, saying, "It's really true. This man was righteous."
I want you to imagine that you are a witness at the cross of Jesus. And particularly today, I want you to imagine that you are a centurion, an officer in the Roman army. And your job is to order your soldiers to crucify Jesus and then make sure that he dies. You do not have any choice in the matter. Pilate has ordered you to kill Jesus, and you trust that Jesus is guilty of the crime of blasphemy for claiming to be the king of the Jews. It is a Friday morning. Your soldiers nail Jesus to the cross and they hoist the cross up into the air. Then you all wait for him to die a slow and painful death. After a while, your soldiers become bored with the waiting, so they play a dice game to win Jesus' clothes to pass the time. You all wait for several hours until Jesus dies. But as you watch Jesus take his last breath, you're standing right under him at the cross. You shock everybody around you as you say, "Truly, this man was the Son of God." You are now horrified that you may have killed an innocent man. You know, wrongful convictions and executions have happened throughout history, and they continue today. A couple examples that I want to share with you. George Stinney, he was a 14-year-old African-American boy. He was executed by electrocution in South Carolina in 1944 for the murder of two young girls. He was the youngest person ever executed in the United States. And later, a judge threw out the conviction, calling it a great injustice. If you were a correction officer who helped with George Stinney's execution, how would you feel knowing that you had killed an innocent boy? And Jesse Tafera was convicted of murder and executed via electric chair in May 1990 in Florida for the murders of two officers. But not only was he wrongly accused, his electric chair malfunctioned 3 times. If you were a correction officer who helped with Jesse Tafero's execution, how would you feel knowing that you had helped to execute an innocent man? After all, you were just doing your job. The judge ordered the execution, and you were following orders. But now, you're horrified that you may have killed somebody who was innocent. Well, this is the same realization that the centurion had as he stood at the foot of Jesus' cross. Let's learn more about this man as we take a closer look at the role of a centurion. So, who were centurions? Well, centurions were Roman army officers who the emperor often appointed. And these men could read and they could write, and they did both police and administrative work, and they were paid extremely well. You know, by today's standards, these men would be in the same class as doctors or engineers or lawyers. They were the wealthiest working people or some of the wealthiest people. Now, do you remember when Jesus told his disciples, if somebody strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other cheek also? Well, Roman army officers or centurions were the most likely people to slap the local people's face. And when Jesus told his disciples, if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, also go the second mile, he was again talking about centurions. When Jesus could no longer carry his cross, a centurion forced Simon of Cyrene to do the heavy lifting. And you see, poor Simon was minding his own business. He was just walking down the road when a centurion suddenly forced him to carry another man's cross. This is how Roman officers impacted the local people. They often felt free to hit him across the face or force them to carry heavy objects for them. So Simon, carrying Jesus' cross, walked behind Jesus on the way to Golgotha. And you know, it makes me think of one of Jesus' teachings. If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. Can you just picture that? You've got Jesus walking, too weak to carry his own cross, being followed by Simon, and he is carrying the cross for him. Simon of Cyrene was literally taking up his cross and following Jesus. All right, so now for a little bit, we're going to leave the cross. We're going to go back in time to Jesus' first encounter with a centurion in the Bible. Now, Jesus had just finished preaching the Sermon on the Mount, and he was now out healing a whole bunch of people. And when he entered Capernaum, he was met by a centurion. Now, when you're met by a centurion, you're probably thinking, am I going to get smacked in the face or am I going to have to carry a load? But instead, the centurion came up to Jesus desperate for help. He told him that my servant, he's paralyzed and he's suffering tremendously at home. And Jesus replied, shall I come and cure him? The centurion's response was surprisingly humble for a Roman military officer. He said, Lord, I am not worthy to have you enter my house, but if you only speak a word, my servant will be healed. How strange that a centurion, the type of man who would normally slap the person or force them to carry a load, recognized that Jesus had more authority than he did. And Jesus was amazed by the centurion's words. He told them, truly I tell you, in no one in Israel have I found such faith. This Roman centurion was not only humble, but he had the faith to know that Jesus could cure his servant with just one spoken word. Now, it's unlikely that this centurion who wanted healing for his servant is the same man as the centurion at the cross. But regardless, his story gets us ready to meet the centurion at the cross. You see, as the centurion first stands by Jesus' cross, he probably thinks, I'm just doing my job. But over the hours, something changes in him. As he watches Jesus die, he exclaims, truly, this man was the Son of God. And how did the centurion come to this conclusion? Well, to answer this question, we need to ask ourselves a question. What do you think was Jesus' main ministry, his primary ministry on earth? Do you think that it was to perform all these miracles and to cure people? No, that wasn't his primary ministry. We know this because after he performed his miracles, he would often tell the people, don't tell anybody about this. If it was his primary ministry, he'd want everybody to know. He would want everybody to come to him for healing. All right, well, if Jesus' primary ministry wasn't to perform miracles, was it maybe to teach? No. His teaching was awesome, but it makes sense that his teaching wasn't his primary ministry because his teaching was often really, really hard to understand, wasn't it? He rarely spoke plainly, and he often spoke in parables, which was like riddles that you had to figure out. All right, so if Jesus' primary mission wasn't to perform miracles and it wasn't to teach, what was it? Jesus' mission was to suffer greatly, be rejected by the religious leaders, be killed, and then to rise again on the third day. And Jesus told his disciples about his mission more than once. He would do it quite openly, quite plainly, so that there was no guessing what he meant. And they just would not accept that this was his mission. They were so in denial that every one of them, except for John, was hiding on the day of the crucifixion. But the centurion, looking at Jesus dying on the cross, understood Jesus's mission at that moment. He said, truly, this man was God's son. Certainly, this man is innocent. So how did the centurion come to this conclusion? He was a witness at the cross, and he had seen many signs, starting by reading the literal sign that was on the top of Jesus's cross that mockingly stated that he was the King of the Jews. The centurion heard the crowd making fun of Jesus, saying, save yourself and come down from that cross. He also watched as his soldiers gambled over Jesus' clothes. But despite all of this abuse, the centurion heard Jesus pray, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. Jesus' prayer was for the soldiers. Jesus' prayer was for him. Did this prayer convince the centurion that Jesus was innocent and righteous? The centurion also heard that Jesus promised the robber on the cross next to him, today you will be with me in paradise. Would Jesus' word have convinced the centurion that Jesus was innocent and righteous? And then, what about the sky? The sky darkening from noon to 3 p.m. Did God have a hand in that, using nature to protest that Jesus was innocent? Or what about Jesus' dying words as he exclaimed, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Would a guilty person say something like this? The centurion claimed Jesus to be righteous and innocent. He was a representative of Rome, and after witnessing Jesus' death on the cross, he couldn't find Jesus guilty of any crime. And the centurion wasn't the only representative of Rome to agree with Jesus' righteousness. Do you remember how Pontius Pilate said three times that Jesus was innocent? And Herod said, "This man has done nothing wrong." What can we learn about the centurion at the cross? Well, that soldiers sometimes execute innocent people. The centurion followed Pilate's orders when he crucified Jesus on the cross. It wasn't until Jesus died that the centurion realized that he had killed an innocent man. Can we forgive the centurion and the soldiers for killing Jesus? Because people continue to execute innocent people. Can we forgive the people who execute individuals and later admit they were wrong? Or can we at least pray that God will forgive them? And if we have done the executing or the judging, can we forgive ourselves? That is what we learn from the centurion at the cross: love and forgiveness. Amen.